Good morning and a very warm welcome to our worship. Please do be seated for the introduction. Today we celebrate the feast of Candlemas, the presentation of Christ in the temple, which properly falls on Tuesday, the 2nd of February, which is 40 days after Christmas. And it marks a kind of turning point. After 40 days of celebrating Christmas and Epiphany, we enter a short period of refocusing before the 40 days of Lent. And so this morning we have the symbolism of both an empty cradle behind me, a last look back to Christmas, and also an empty cross as we anticipate all that will unfold before we celebrate again the great feast of Easter. Candlemas is also one of the most Jewish of Christian festivals, as we recall a devout Jewish family making their way to the temple and being met by Simeon and Anna, two characters who could have jumped straight from the pages of the Old Testament. In recognition of that Jewish heritage, then, this morning we offer sacrifice, symbolizing God's coming among us, and also our prayers, our worship, rising to the throne of heaven. Before we do that, we greet this feast with an acclamation which starts and ends with three alleluias, which I will say at the beginning, and at the end, I invite you to join in with great gusto. So please stand for that acclamation. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Today the Lord is presented in his temple, in substance of our mortal nature. Today the Blessed Virgin comes to be purified in accordance with the law. Today old Simeon proclaims Christ as the light of the nations and the glory of Israel. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. 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 Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, light of the nations and glory of Israel, make your home among us and present us, pure and holy, to your heavenly Father, your God and our God. Amen.
Amen.
Would you please sit for our first reading?
A reading from the book of the prophet Malachi. Thus says the Lord God, see, I am sending my messenger to prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant in whom you delight, indeed, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. But who can endure the day of his coming, and who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like fuller's soap. He will sit as a refiner and a purifier of silver, and he will purify the descendants of Levi and refine them like gold and silver, until they present offerings to the Lord in righteousness. Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasing to the Lord, as in the days of old and as in former years. Then I will draw near to you for judgment. I will be swift to bear witness against the sorcerers, against the adulterers, against those who swear falsely, against those who oppress the hired workers in their wages, the widow and the orphan, against those who thrust aside the alien and do not fear me, says the Lord of hosts. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And now between our readings, Rebecca will sing for us Howard Goodall's setting of Psalm 23, The Lord is my shepherd.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the time came for the purification according to the law of Moses, Mary and Joseph brought Jesus up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the Lord. And they offered a sacrifice, according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and for glory to your people Israel." And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to his mother, Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed. And a sword will pierce your own soul too." There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age, having lived with her husband for 7 years after her marriage, then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshipped there with fasting and prayer, night and day. At that moment she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who are looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. When they had finished everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May my words and all our thoughts be now and always acceptable to God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. One of my favourite radio programmes is Radio 4's The Unbelievable Truth, hosted by David Mitchell. The show's contestants basically spout nonsense, but try to smuggle in 5 highly improbable but true statements. And it's the job of the others to try and identify those true facts before anyone else. One of the facts that I learned this week was that the second person to throw himself over the Niagara Falls in a barrel was an Englishman, Bobby Leach, who accomplished this feat in 1911. And the unbelievable truth was that Bobby Leach survived that hugely risky fall, only then to die 15 years later after slipping on a piece of orange peel. Bizarre, but true. The second odd thing I've gleaned is that there is a condition called galanthomania, which means being besotted with or addicted to snowdrops, those innocent little clumps of white flowers that decorate our churchyards and hedgerows at this time of year. Apparently, some people just can't get enough of them. And the unbelievable truth is that in 2015, one tiny snowdrop bulb, one bulb, sold for £1,360, plus £4 postage and package. That was a rare variety of snowdrop called Golden Fleece, perhaps because it was worth its weight in gold, perhaps because we might think that whoever paid that price for one bulb has been well and truly fleeced. In any case, it is the more common pure white ones that I want to think about this morning. These proper snowdrops used to be known as Candlemas bells, appearing as they do just about this time of the Feast of Candlemas. And they were often used to decorate churches as a symbol of both hope and warning. The green shoots celebrating the new life of spring, but the snow-white petals cautioning that winter has not yet lost its icy grip. And that's where these Candlemas bells tie in with the gospel reading we've just heard. Simeon's prophecy is of the great and wonderful things that this tiny child will go on to achieve, but also of the hardship and suffering that will be caused along the way. What begins as a perfect picture of Jewish ritual, two parents fulfilling the law of Moses, soon starts to become more than that, as Simeon describes Jesus as a light for revelation to the Gentiles, the non-Jewish nations of the world, as well as the glory of his own people. A promise of greatness, and yet ahead lies the pain of separation. First of Jewish Christians exiled from the synagogues, and also of Jews and Christians in the centuries ever since. A promise of greatness, and yet Jesus himself would face the fierce disapproval of both religious authorities and secular powers, causing his family grief in more senses than one. No wonder then that Mary and Joseph were amazed by Simeon's words, astonished at the prospect of what lay ahead of them. Six verses later in Luke's Gospel, we find the teachers gathered in the temple at Passover, listening intently as the 12-year-old Jesus questions them. And they are amazed at his words and his evident wisdom, both an inspiration and a challenge to their own authority. Both experiences are awesome in the literal sense, something to be marveled at, but also profoundly unsettling, leaving the onlookers to wonder at such unbelievable truths and the collision of hope and fear they seem to provoke. And perhaps that's a tension that we can identify with as we enter this vague in-between time in the church's year and as we look at the world around us. The green shoots of hope are beginning to poke through into our consciousness. How could we not be amazed at just how quickly COVID-19 vaccines have been developed and vaccine centres organised, with thousands of vaccinations having taken place already here in Wilton? And yet we can't quite escape the icy grip of fear, or at least anxiety, when we are presented with headlines about more than 100,000 COVID-related deaths in the UK. There is no disguising the real human misery behind those figures. Our cathedral made the international headlines last week with a very nice piece in the New York Times, celebrating not only one of the most tranquil settings in which to have your jab, but also the fact that the cathedral organists were busy providing musical accompaniment in the background. Nothing to fear there, you might think. But there were complaints that this was not a proper use for a church. One Instagrammer called it a desecration. Really? Was that just fear of something new, of something out of the ordinary? Given that Jesus was not exactly shy of healing in the temple, even on the Sabbath, and his fairly blunt response to the religious busybodies who criticized him for it, I think that the cathedral chapter was absolutely right to open their doors in this way. Another musical news story appeared on Thursday in which two negatives merged to form a positive. We've been aware for some time of long COVID, of people who survived COVID-19 but who are left with damaged lungs and other ongoing health problems. At the same time, there has been a real crisis in the performing arts, with venues closed and most live performances prohibited. Out of these two causes of anxiety, a new hope emerged. Members of English National Opera have begun offering online group singing lessons to long COVID sufferers, working through simple melodies and lullabies to relieve anxiety, teaching techniques of breath control in order to make best use of damaged lungs, whilst also providing valuable work for the singers themselves. Despite the real challenges of a virus that we don't still fully understand, despite the negativity of some of our neighbours, there are still pleasant surprises. Surprises which should amaze us. The green shoots are bursting through. And perhaps that's the final lesson of the humble common snowdrop. No matter what the previous year has thrown at them, whether it's been wet, dry, scorching hot, bitterly cold, come February, those persistent little flowers will be back. New shoots appear and slowly, quietly transform the landscape, almost without our noticing them, until one day we look up and see that transformation that's taken place. Then, in turn, we might be changed by the freshness and beauty of that new growth, and our anxiety turned again to wonder. In a similar way, it seems to me, our recovery from this time of uncertainty is not just down to us, any more than the natural cycle of the snowdrop is. No matter what we do or feel, it seems, life goes on one way or another. But perhaps we can train ourselves to recognize and celebrate those first signs of progress, to face the weeks ahead, not just with grim determination, but with that same active persistence. Simeon and Anna were faithful and persistent in their belief that they would see the Christ, and they were rewarded. Can we, like them, be persistent in prayer, even when we don't much feel like it, so that hope is kept alive in us? Can we be persistent in looking for the signs of redemption, even when the headlines are grim? Malachi remained confident that God's messenger would come to purify and restore his people. Can we make this period of uncertainty the time of our purification, shedding those negative things which weigh us down, or at least putting them into perspective, so that we will be ready to share in the new life that will flourish in ways we don't yet see? However we get on with any of that, wherever it might lead any of us, perhaps we can all be encouraged by the resilience of our little snowdrops, seemingly fragile and easily crushed, yet somehow able to spring back again and again. May we pray and trust that God's life-giving Spirit will give us that same strength and resilience. Amen. Let us stand then to affirm our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I believe. Would you please sit for our prayers of intercession? Let us pray to the Father through Christ, who is our light and our life. Let us pray for the church, for our churches here, for Nicholas, Andrew, and Karen, our bishops, and for the whole Church of Christ, as together we seek to proclaim his good news in our times. Let us pray for the world and for the leaders of the nations, that the threatened politicization of COVID vaccines may be averted, and a spirit of cooperation and mutual support may be fostered. And let us pray for our community and for ourselves, giving thanks for all that is good and flourishing, and placing into God's hands all that causes us anxiety or sadness. The response to each petition now is, Lord, hear us, Lord, graciously hear us. Father, your Christ is acclaimed as the glory of Israel. Look in mercy on your church, sharing his light. Lord, hear us, Lord graciously hear us. Father, your Christ in his temple brings judgment on the world. Look in mercy on the nations who long for his justice. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Father, your Christ, who was rich, for our sakes became poor. Look in mercy on all who are in need and all who are suffering today. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Father, your Christ is the one in whom faithful servants find peace. Look in mercy on the departed, that they may see your salvation. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Father, your Christ is revealed as the one destined to be rejected. Look in mercy on us, who now turn towards his passion. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Lord God, you kept faith with Simeon and Anna and showed them the infant King. Give us grace to put all our trust in your promises and the patience to wait for their fulfillment through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen. We come now to our prayers of penitence, and as we look to Lent, let us consider where we have fallen short of what God asks of us. Hear the words of our Saviour Jesus Christ. I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me shall never walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. Let us therefore bring our sins into his light, and let us seek his healing and forgiveness, praying with confidence in the words our Saviour gave us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
May Almighty God, who sent his Son into the world to save sinners, bring us his pardon and his peace, now and forever. Amen. And let us stand and share Christ's peace, not by shaking hands, but by nodding when we get to that point, if you'd like to. Please, would you stand? In the tender mercy of our God, the dayspring from on high has broken upon us to give light to those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. And now we remain standing as the cloth from the cradle is reshaped to adorn the cross. And while that takes place, Rebecca will sing for us again, "The Lord Bless You and Keep You" by John Rutter.
Thank you.
And the final responsory, a series of statements to which the response is, "Blessed be God forever." Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe. Blessed be God forever. Your light shines on us, and all people shall see your glory. Blessed be God forever. You gave us Jesus to be the light of the world. He makes our darkness to be light. Blessed be God forever. Through the Holy Spirit, your love burns within us, bearing witness to your truth. Blessed be God forever. As in our minds we bear your light, may our lips never cease to proclaim your praise. Blessed be God forever. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God forever. Christ, whose glory fills the skies, fill you with radiance and scatter the darkness from your path. Christ, the Son of righteousness, gladden your eyes and warm your heart. Christ, the dayspring from on high, draw near to guide your feet into the way of peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.